minus 4y. 3x plus 4y. Equals 8. So we're using the substitution approach as opposed to the graphing approach. So what are we going to do? What do we substitute for what else?
X and y. Substitute. Well, we don't know what y equals because it doesn't say that. We know what x equals, so you substitute that for 3. So it's going to be now 3 times 16 minus 4y.
Make sure to put parentheses there so that, because you're replacing x, like, completely. And what is 3 supposed to do? It's supposed to be multiplied by x, right? Mm-hmm. And now x is that whole thing, 16 minus 4y. Right? So we're going to make sure that 3 is distributed to everything in that expression. Then plus 4y equals 8. Okay, so 3 times 16, 48, minus 12y plus 4y equals 8. Solving for y here. 48 minus 8 minus 48 on both sides, and negative 8y equals negative 40 divided by negative 8. 5. So we're done?
No. We're going to go back to x and
find that x. So x is equal, so y is 5. We're just going to scroll up and write that here, y equals 5. Well, x equals 16 minus 4 times whatever y is. So x equals 16 minus 20, right? 4 times 5 minus 20. X equals negative 4, so we're done? We just gotta say it. Like, I need to see that you know what we're looking for, and that is a pair of numbers that solves both equations.
I get
them. Is that?
I get this one.
You get this now. Were you in class last time?
I was.
And you didn't get it then?
For some reason I didn't.
Alright, well. A new day. Sometimes things just click in a new day. Yeah.
All it takes is that one last problem.
Sometimes it is. Okay, so now we'll have a slightly less cooperative problem. That's decimals. Also, make substitution a bit of a challenge. 1.8y plus 5.5x is equal to 27.6. Okay. Well, in this last example, we were able to substitute something in for x here because the first equation was nice enough to tell us x is this. But in this one, neither of the equations yet, neither of the equations says this is what x is or this is what y is. So we kind of need to just kind of grab one of those equations by the collar and make it tell us what x is or what y is. Right? We gotta rearrange it so it says y is this or x is this, y equals this or x equals that. So which one can we use to do that most easily? Subtract 0.2x.
Yeah, on both sides, and then you have y equals.
Y equals. Very good. So you get the y right there. So if you work on those equations for your homework, because you're gonna turn it in later, right? Get credit for it. Look for that solitary x or y, right? It might be negative, but that's no big deal. Then you just have to switch the signs. But look for that solitary y or x. It's just begging to be isolated on one side by itself. And here we add negative 0.2x. Minus 1.8, right? By subtracting 0.2x and 0.2x, we get this guy here. And now we know that y is that. So what are we going to do with that, Noah?
You're going to plug it in for y.
Plug it in for y right there?
Yep. Wait. No, you would.
Into this one, right?
Yep.
If you ever do this, and sometimes it happens, if you ever rearrange an equation and get y, kind of lose track, and then put it right back into the equation you just used, what do you think will happen when you go to solve for y? Actually, it would be solving for x in that case. yes and no in a way. Watch what happens. 2.2x plus negative 0.2x minus 1.8, yeah. That's why. Okay. Negative 1.8 on the other side. Okay. A lot of these things are exactly the same. No surprise, but they just came from this equation. So we get 0.2x minus 0.2x minus 1.8 equals negative 1.8. And what's 0.2x minus 0.2x? 0. So we get negative 1.8 equals negative 1.8. Right? An equation so simple, you probably first saw it in first grade. Right? A number equals itself. Of course it does. If we backed up to this equation, do you think there's any equation or any value of x I could plug in here that would like make this not work? Let's plug in 1 for x. 1, 1. 0.2 times 1 is 0.2. Negative 0.2 times 1 is negative 0.2. So 0.2 minus 0.2 is 0. Whatever you plug in for x, this part, what's going to happen with this part? Every time, no matter what you plug in for x,
it's going to cancel out.
It's going to cancel itself out. You will always wind up with this, which is true or false? This is true or it's false?
Well, in that case, it'd be true. It's false because there's no y. There's not even an x there. It's just saying
so. If somehow, and this will happen in further sections, but if I ever wind up with just like no more x's or y's, they just cancel each other out, and so, and this answer is a true statement, right? This equation is a true statement because both sides are equal, then that would be infinite solutions. Okay, but this only happened because we plugged it back into the wrong equation, right? It'd be kind of like we had a system of equations where this was one equation and this was the second equation. When that actually comes up, it'll be a little more sneaky than that. Okay, but again, that happened because we plugged it into the wrong equation. We plugged it back into the equation we just solved for y. So let's not do that. Let's plug it back into this equation. So 1.8 times negative 0.2x minus 1.8, that's what y is equal to, plus 5.5x equals 27.6. 1.8 times negative 0.2x is 2.6. No, I think it's 3.6. No, that'd be times 2. Let's see, times 2, so I think it's 0.36. I don't know, let me just have to check. 1.8 times, that's not 1.8. 1.8 times 0.2. Negative 0.36x. 1.8 times negative 1.8. 1.8. Negative 3.24. Negative 3.24. 5.5x equals 27.6. Negative 0.36x plus 5.5x. 5.5 minus 0.36. What was it? We didn't have an answer yet. 5.14. So we have 5.14x minus 3.24 equals 27.6. Now what?
Add 3.24.
So 27.6 plus 3.24, 30.84, 5.14x equals 30.84. Divide both sides by 5.14. 6, x equals 6. Okay, now that I know x equals 6, I can solve for y. Y equals negative 0.2 times 6 minus 1.8. So 6 times 0.2, y equals negative 1.2 minus 1.8. Y equals negative 3, and our solution is 6 negative 3. So it was kind of a hassle there because there was all these decimals involved, but as long as we don't make any little arithmetic error, it's not really any different than not having decimals. Any questions before we do the review? Got a piece of paper ready. So, let's start us off. What would we do first?
Subtract 2 from both sides.
Subtract 2? Both sides of what?
Of 9 and
the first one.
Yeah.
Subtract 2.
Don't you divide 2?
Yeah, divide.
Divide 2?
Divide. Just subtract 2.
Alright, I'll take this equation 2x plus y equals 9. I'll subtract 2. Subtract 2. And, well, 2 isn't like terms with x or y, so.
2x.
Okay, 2x. Alright. So, write down what you said.
Alright.
Okay, subtract 2x. Okay, and. We get y by itself. Y equals 9 minus 2x. So now we know that y is equal to 9 minus 2x. Dustin, what would you do next?
Add 2 to 9.
Add 2 to 9. I think we're done with this equation. We got y by itself. That's what we wanted to use this equation for. So what would we do with that? Telling us that y is 9 minus 2x. So in this other equation, I can replace y with 9 minus 2x. So negative 4x plus 9 minus 2x equals 15. Okay. Now we'll just solve for x. You got negative 6x plus 9 equals 15. Minus 9 minus 9. Negative 6x equals 6. X equals negative 1. Now we know x equals negative 1, let's use this equation here. Y equals 9 minus 2 times, oops, 9 minus 2 times negative 1. Y equals 9 plus 2, y equals 11. Negative 1, 11. Okay. Practice, like,
you know, I got 3 for a year that subtracted 2 from the 4, so I had to use 2x instead.
Nah.
Yeah.
Okay, well, let's get out our notes. Okay, something we need to work on as a class is taking good notes and doing our homework, apparently, is something we need to work on. Okay? So, let's make up a scenario in just a second, because I've just had to make up a scenario in the top of my head. So let me just come up with some info here. Alright. So let's just imagine that you're in charge of the cash box at a, let's just say it's a play. Okay, there's a play, and you are taking, money for tickets, or selling people tickets, and as they come through, okay? And what you know at the end of the night, when you get all done, is that the amount of money that you made, okay, it's your profit that's in the cash box, is $500. By selling tickets, you've taken in $500. And you know that the total amount of tickets is 85 tickets total. The thing about it is that there are student tickets and adult tickets, right? But you forgot to count them as the two separate groups. Okay? All you can remember is that you made $500 and that you sold 85 tickets. Of course, you know how much the student tickets and adult tickets cost. The student tickets, they cost, how much do they make them cost? $5. Okay. And the adult tickets cost $8. All right, so we made a total of $500. We know we sold 85 tickets. That student tickets cost $5 and adult tickets cost $8. Okay. What we're gonna do is work on learning how to use a system of equations to figure out how many X student tickets there were sold and how many Y adult tickets there were sold. So see if you can start by writing two equations for this scenario. Okay, so can we write an equation involving the total money made? Noah, can you explain that one to me? Why 5 times x? Why is, I keep saying why. How come there's a 5 times x there?
$5 for a student and a student is x.
Right, there's x number of students. And so the same reasoning for the adults, $8 per adult times y number of adults. And when we add up those $2 amounts, it should come out to be $100. Noah, do you have a second equation that we can write? Probably has something to do with 85, we're going to use 85. Okay. So I asked you to write an equation that has to do with the number of students and the prices and the total amount made. Isn't there, should there be some kind of relationship between the number of students, the number of adults, and the total number of tickets sold?
It would be y equals x minus 85.
Y equals x minus 85. So let's replace these variable letters with words. So the number of students, minus 85, 85 being the total number of tickets, should give us the
number of adults.
What's bigger, the number of students who came or the number of total people who came?
The number of total people.
So if I subtract 85 from a number that's smaller than 85, get a negative.
So it'd be 85 minus 9.
I take 85 the total and subtract the number of students, I should get the number of adults. Okay, we're not solving the system yet. We're just writing the two equations.
Oh, x plus y equals 85.
Yeah, I had it, and I just scribbled it all out.
That's
wrong.
Right. I'm just learning. For me, I don't really, I wouldn't have thought of that at first. I would have thought the number of students plus the number of adults equals the total number of people, right? But if I subtract x from both sides, then I get exactly what Cameron said.
I just skipped that part.
Did you write down x plus y equals 85?
No, I skipped it. I don't know why.
Did you think x plus y equals 85?
Yeah.
Ah, quit showing up. Start where your thoughts started. Okay? But it's fine. It's true that the number of students, if you subtract it from the total number of people, it gives you the number of adults. And you have the wrong equation here. You got x minus 85.
Well, I did it backwards.
Maybe you should write it down first.
Yeah. It should have.
You're not impressing anybody. You're just doing work for yourself. You don't have to skip steps.
I like work. I am step skipper.
Well, don't be that guy.
I am that guy.
Don't be that
guy. And his brother.
So here we have two equations. We solved one of them for y, and as Branson alluded to, we're going to take that and replace this y with 85 and x. Because the number of adults is the same as the total minus the number of students. Okay. Now we can kind of see, even more so when these numbers actually represent something, how we can replace y with something else. Because either way, it's the same thing. Either it's the number of adults, or it's something that's equal to the number of adults, students taken away from the total. And then we just work this all out. 8 times 85 minus x equals 500. So 5x plus 680, thank you, minus 8x equals 500. Negative 3x plus 680 equals 500. Negative 3x equals negative 180, subtracting 680 from both sides. Divide by negative 3 and x equals 60. Okay, so 60 of what? What does 60 mean? 60 students. Yeah, this is going to be pretty easy since it's a fairly simple relationship between the number of students and the number of adults and the total number of people who showed up. How many adults must have shown up?
25.
You just kind of look up here and do it in your head. Pretty simple one. So, if we were to say the solution, this is a good way to say the solution. X is 60, y is 25. Or we could also say 60 times 25. Or even better, since it's a real situation, we can say 60 students and the tricky part is not so much solving the system. Those numbers were kind of nice, right? But the tricky part, I would say, is writing the equations in the first place. That's usually the hardest part of outward problems, is writing the equations. Right? Solving the equations is usually the easier part. So that's what today is about. We're practicing interpreting a real-life thing and putting it into equation form. All right? So let's use, for example, okay. So the sand volleyball court, in case you're not familiar with the sand volleyball court, it's a bunch of sand, a rectangle, okay. The rectangular part inside of that is the volleyball. Here's the net here, okay. So it says that for the volleyball court, the length is twice its width. Is twice its width. And the perimeter is 180 feet. What do you think they want us to find? Well, okay, what would x and y represent? The length and width of the court, right? We're going to figure out what the length and width of the court are. So we could call x the length and y the width. We could call L the length and W the width. That too. Either way you like it. Okay, but if we did use x as the length and y as the width, alright, this is the challenge. Like, this is the difficult part. This is the part I want you to practice writing these equations given that information. Okay. So, I mean, they kind of make it cut and dry for you. The length is twice the width, and they're saying the perimeter is 180 feet. Is there a relationship between the length and the width? Well, clearly, it's telling us that there is. Is there a relationship between the perimeter and the length and the width? Just remind us, what's the perimeter mean? The perimeter of a shape? Just the length and the width?
Length and the width of all four sides.
All four sides. Add up all four sides. Huh?
Well, they said twice, so it's like onward against width.
What?
Multiplying it by two.
Okay, you can take the length and multiply by two, and the width multiply the width by two, and add those two together, and it'll be the same. Okay.
Or add both of them together and multiply.
And then we're adding both together and multiply that number. All of that works. Okay? So we're saying it out loud, and the words are coming out of our mouths, but we didn't put it into equation form. Okay? So given that you know what the perimeter is, and you know that the perimeter measures 180 feet, and you know that there's this relationship between the length and the width, right? Go to town, write some equations. Okay? And then we'll work on. So let's talk about our two equations. If I'm calling the x, the length x, then I could write x there. And if the width is y, put y there. Okay. If you're not in the habit of drawing pictures, you really ought to be. It really helps to visualize this stuff. So, how did we find the perimeter of a rectangle? Of all the sides?
Yeah.
Okay, so we gotta go around and add this side to this side to this side to this side?
You can multiply.
Okay, so this side and this side are the same. This side and this side are the same, so instead of adding it twice, we can just multiply it by 2. So we have 2x's, 2x, and we add 2y's to that, plus 2y, and that comes out to be?
180.
180, alright. That's one equation. Now this one says length is twice the width, and this word is, right? It's kind of a strong word. If I say somebody is something from a purely mathematical perspective, I'm saying that they are that thing. Or if I say something is something else, I'm making an equivalence between those two. I'm saying this is that other thing. Okay? So if I say Branson's a jerk, Branson is a jerk. Like everything that Branson is, he's a jerk. He is a jerk. It's kind of strong.
Here's
right?
The word jerk, dude.
So, now what a jerk is kind of a. There's not a good definition for that. But when we say is, we're making equivalence. So, what it's saying here is somebody's going around saying length. Hey, the length. You heard about that length? He is twice the width. So, when you say is, we mean. Especially in math, we're saying that it is equal to. Okay, what's equal to what?
Twice
the width. So something. What's the something that's equal to something else? Like, what could I put on this side?
One.
Y is. Y is what? What are we calling the length right now? What variable are we using to call the length?
X.
Okay, so it's x. Length is x, so x is, like the length is, what's the width being called?
Y.
Y, the width is y. Okay, well, x is something about y, like x and y have this relationship. And x is equal to, if I took y and did what with it?
Multiply twice.
Multiply by 2. Now, a lot of people will wind up with the statements like this. They'll wind up with y equals 2x. And we can cut backwards sometimes. If you didn't, then great. But sometimes it happens. So the length is twice the width. The length is twice the width. I almost took this word for word and put it into an equation using, replacing words with symbols. Well, replacing words with symbols. Sometimes a variable symbol, sometimes an equal sign symbol. Alright? And, well, here's a kind of cool thing. Well, x is equal to 2, right? So I could replace this x with this 2y, couldn't I? You see that? Now here's a trick. It makes it a little bit easier, just ever so slightly easier. X, right? X is 2y, but what is 2y? Well, I guess I'm just trying to get you to look at it backwards. X is equal to 2y, but what's 2y equal to?
2y is equal to x.
2y is equal to x. Do you see the 2y anywhere else?
Yeah.
Where?
Right there.
there. So I could replace this x with this 2y, or since this is 2y and 2y is the same as x, I could replace this 2y with x.
So it'd be 2x plus x.
That's right. Is equal to 180. And then we solve for x, 3x equals 180. And x equals 60. Right? And, well, x is equal to 60, so that must be y is equal to 30. Right? So y is equal to 30. And so x is 60 and y is 30. The length is 60 and the width is 30. 60 times 30, well, no, 60 plus 60 plus 30 plus 30 is 180. And yeah, this is twice as big as this. Writing these equations, this is, I think I'm pretty good at writing an equation myself, and I do not know how I would have gotten good at writing equations if I didn't write lots of equations over and over and over, and write equations incorrectly over and over and over, and then realize, like, oh, that's what I should have written. Like, I wrote this stuff backwards all the time. X should have been equal to 2y, but I'll write y is equal to 2x. I would do it all the time, so I had to learn. Watch out for that. Like, that's just a trigger for me. When I see whatever is twice of whatever, or whatever is 5 less than whatever else, I have to just watch myself and think, okay, so which, I know it's going to be like something is equal to 2 times something, okay? But I need to be careful and make sure that I go the right way to write this equation correctly. Right? So the moral of the story here is, I'm going to get better at word problems and writing equations. Do lots of word problems and write lots of equations. And write probably more equations incorrectly than correctly. Okay? Until you start to learn your mistakes that you make. And start to fix those mistakes before you make them, because you know you're prone to making them. Right? So there's the homework right there. Just four problems, four word problems. And instead of looking at the word problem and saying, word problems are hard, and I'm not going to do very well, right? We've got a little less than a half hour to...